Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. The third week of March 2025 brought little comfort to the upgrade-starved PC gaming masses, who despite being promised cool new GPUs all year so far, still cannot reasonably purchase said GPUs for anything less than a $150 markup or so over MSRP. Or in the case of the RTX 5090, go ahead and double that $2,000 starting price to $4,000. Meanwhile, tech channels and influencers are callously flaunting their ill-begotten video card stock with shameless bespoke PC build videos, obviously too far removed in their ivory towers from the plight of the common gamer to hear their wails of agonized suffering. Huh? Nope, nothing. Sure, there might be some reason for hope, but it's a fool's hope. For Nvidia themselves showed just how much they still care about GPUs for PC gaming this week by ignoring them almost completely at GTC. Sorry, 5060 and 5060 Ti holdouts, those have been delayed. What a great time to be a PC gamer! On the plus side though, we can now make batteries from salt.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's TR100 Mini Tower Case and Travel Trunk. The TR100 is a diminutive but full-featured dual-chamber chassis with a surprisingly roomy interior for high-end PC builds, available in a variety of colors with support for up to 360mm GPUs and a 280mm AIO radiator on top. The modular design means side panels are all removable for cable management, and upgrades include an optional LCD panel or the Travel Trunk to easily take your TR100 gaming PC setup on the go. For more on the TR100 Mini Tower Case from Thermaltake, check out my build or click the sponsor link in the video description. We begin with a baffling continuation of GPU Shortage 2025. Somehow, inexplicably, there just aren't enough GPUs in desktop gaming graphics card trim available to meet the demand for PC gamers out there. And gosh, experts and analysts alike are flummoxed as to why we're in this situation. Sarcasm aside though, we've known for some time that AI data centers and cloud service providers do a much better job at greasing Nvidia's palm when it comes to profit per TSMC wafer versus gamers, but the true disparity in allocation has been made starkly evident by statements made at GTC this week. 3.6 million Blackwell GPUs have been sold so far in 2025 to the top four US-based cloud service providers alone, not including AI or other data center clients, and that is a lot of TSMC allocation, especially considering that Blackwell data center GPUs use the largest die size possible, meaning a single TSMC wafer will yield fewer of those GPUs versus the GB205 used for the 5070 or the GB203 used for the 5080 or 5070 Ti, for example. We don't know how many RTX 50 series video cards have been sold so far, but it's a fair assumption that AMD has sold more RX 9070 and 9070 XTs based on the post-launch data that did trickle in. And inventory data from Micro Center 5 or 6 weeks ago showed initial 5090 and 5080 stock to be in the tens and hundreds for the 5090, and maybe the thousands for the 5080. So when reports came on Tuesday that AMD said they had sold 200,000 RX 9070s in the past couple weeks, it was accepted pretty quickly, even though AMD clarified later that day that they did not actually say that, and the BenchLife article that it was originated from was taken down. Which brings us no closer to knowing how many RTX 50 series GPUs have been sold, but let's speculate anyway. The infamous Micro Center list counted about 2,600 5080s and 5090s sold just on launch day from one retailer here in the US, but info from other retailers indicated Micro Center got the lion's share of the cards at launch. If we add the 5070 Ti and 5070 to that count, expand to all retailers worldwide, and vaguely estimate how many additional cards Nvidia and board partners have been able to restock in the past 2 to 6 weeks, we would be doing a lot of assuming. But I'd be willing to bet $5 that total 50 series shipments are in the five-figure range, or possibly low six figures, which makes the now debunked 200,000 Radeon GPUs shipped number somewhat reasonable. And if we take that almost completely made up value, apply it to Nvidia instead, and compare it to the 3.6 million data center Blackwell GPUs shipped, it's about 5.5%. 5.5% or fewer Nvidia GPUs sold so far in 2025 have been gaming GPUs, in theory, and I welcome Nvidia to come out with some hard data to confirm or deny or correct this, but it's probably not as big of a stretch as multi-frame gen gives an RTX 5070 the same performance as an RTX 4090. We can at least reference some slightly harder data, giggity, via JPR reports for 2024 showing industry-wide discrete GPU sales, which was about 36 million units in the past year or so, or about 3 million per month. But note that this includes all GPU manufacturers and the entire spectrum of price tiers, including older generation cards. So even if that 200K number was accurate, it still seems to be short of what's needed to keep up with typical demand, let alone the situation that we're in right now. Still, despite all this, there is reason to hold out hope. AMD seems to be gaining market share, at least in Japan, where it's 45% and climbing. And if there's one thing that might convince Jensen's halo of advisors at Nvidia that allocating more wafers for gaming cards is a good idea, it's a noticeable dent in that part of their business, which I'm hoping at least a few of them still value for its long-term reliability. There was also a note from Chinese board partner Yestin on Monday that claims RX 9070 and 9070 XT availability will improve in April. Now, there haven't been any similar promises from Nvidia board partners, but there was one way to get a 50 series card this week that didn't involve waiting in line at Micro Center. Waiting in line at GTC, where Nvidia apparently made several thousand RTX 5090s and 5080s available to attendees, which were sold out of a food truck alongside Nvidia merch. Now, you might consider this like a Newegg-style forced combo, since it required a GTC pass to access, which costs around $1,000 to $2,500 depending on how many days you signed up for, and you weren't even guaranteed a Founders Edition, since even Nvidia doesn't have enough of those. AIB cards were also on offer. And sadly, as far as I could tell, this was the biggest nod towards PC gaming at GTC, which built Nvidia as a company for 30 plus years at the GTC show. We had hoped that a 5060 and 5060 Ti announcement was in the works, and perhaps it was at one point, but per industry rumors on the board channel's forums, Nvidia has been notifying partners that the launch for those two cards is being pushed back, with the 5060 Ti 8 and 16 gig now coming in mid-April, and the 5060 landing in mid-May, which is also when Computex is this year. Further info leaked to videocards.com now also seems to confirm the specs for these cards, which will theoretically cost less than the $550 RTX 5070. The 5060 Ti will use the GB206-300 die with 4,608 CUDA cores, a 180-watt TGP, and a 2,572MHz boost clock, while the 5060 runs on a GB206-250 with 3,840 cores, 150 watts of power, and clock speeds TBD. Some interesting stuff was announced at GTC too, though. It was all just very data center and AI focused and seemed very geared towards impressing investors versus sharing anything that might interest PC gamers. Even the robotics part, which revealed a droid called Newton that was a collaboration between DeepMind, Disney Research, and Nvidia, seemed way more interested in recreating a cute semi-anthropomorphic BB-8 or R2-D2 knockoff with its beeping and blooping sounds and its blinky eyes than making something actually functional or useful, which to me was a great representation of who Nvidia wants to speak to right now, and it's not us gamers, it's investors with deep pockets and limited understanding of the underlying technology who will look at Newton and think, oh, how cute, let's buy some Nvidia stock. For our purposes though, there was more shared on the Rubin architecture that will eventually replace Blackwell in 2026, with Rubin Ultra coming in 2027, and while the data center configurations that Nvidia will be selling sport some truly mind-blowing theoretical performance numbers, I can't help but think that Rubin will likely be the generation that leaves gaming GPUs behind. Since Rubin will be manufactured on TSMC's 3-nanometer equivalent process, I would not be the least bit surprised to see some form of Blackwell refresh for the RTX 60 series or 50 Super series that continues to use TSMC 4N so that all the Rubin yields can be allocated for data center AI chips. Then the RTX 70 series can be based on Rubin, because by that time Nvidia will be producing their next-gen chips with architecture codenamed Feynman, after American theoretical physicist Richard Feynman, which was also just announced, but without many details. Feynman could be produced on TSMC's 2N process, or possibly Intel 18A or 14A. Speaking of theoretical physics, let's continue our test of whether or not time is immutable on this week's Tech Briefs. There have been various threats to Windows' dominance as an OS for gaming PCs over the years, but this could be the most legitimate. Valve has at long last released Steam OS to the public, meaning you can run it on third-party non-Steam Deck devices, where it often provides better performance due to reduced overhead versus Windows. Great news for someone who might want to try it out on an Asus ROG Ally or Lenovo Legion, but my thoughts immediately went to installing it on a desktop. desktop PC, where, yes, Linux gaming is already a thing and can be set up, but if a company like Valve was able to streamline SteamOS for easy installation, updates, and cross-compatibility on desktop hardware, I bet there would be a lot of people who'd be happy to kiss Microsoft Windows goodbye. Speaking of things that are probably at least a few years out, the PCI Express Gen 7 spec was also finalized this week, and I feel like the PC Gamer headline sums it up nicely. While, yes, it's cool to see standards advance, and predictably the 7.0 update doubles bandwidth yet again, delivering a 128GB transfers per second raw bitrate and up to 512GB per second bidirectionally via a full-size x16 configuration, we're also just barely starting to see PCIe 5.0 gain wider adoption, and PCIe 6 is still almost entirely vaporware currently, even though it was finalized back in 2022. So we're probably still 3 to 5 years away from actually being able to buy a Gen 7 motherboard or GPU or SSD. Maybe when AMD's AM7 platform launches, that would align nicely. Finally, we have a power bank, but it's powered by salt. Specifically, a sodium ion battery, which I want to call Nion, is what stores the electrons in this unit from Elecom, the world's first retail device with the new battery technology. On the plus side, sodium ion batteries are safer and more environmentally friendly than lithium ion, since the material is way more prevalent, and they're also more durable, going 5,000 or so charges before degrading versus 500 with lithium ion. They can also tolerate much lower temperatures, down to -35°C, but the downside is they're larger and heavier, with comparable battery banks weighing 350 grams for sodium versus 150 for lithium. They'll probably get better as the technology matures, and I think we should credit NVIDIA for creating such a recycling-rich environment for sodium ion batteries. Thanks to the RTX 50 series launch, there's currently a near-infinite supply of gamers' tears. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button, or you can leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you next week.